Morning, New Life Church. My name is Lindsay, and these are my kids, Case and Camille, and we are members here at New Life Church. And we'd like to welcome you today, whether it's your first time with us, or you're a regular member, or you're a member we haven't seen in a while. We're so glad that you joined us today. If you're a guest with us, I hope you received some coffee, a warm welcome, some cookies in the atrium. You also may have received the Connect card. Hold that up, guys. This is our Connect card. So if you didn't receive one out front, you may have seen the QR codes. So if you didn't get a physical card, you can scan that QR code. They do have some out at the foyer, at the tables, and at the welcome booth. So this is the way for our staff to connect with you. Whether you're new here or you're a member, please fill this out. And on the back, flip it over. On the back is a very important part for our church. This is a place where you can put your prayer requests. Or your praises. They like to send those out as well. But if you'd like to keep it confidential, make sure you check the box on the bottom, and that will just be shared with our staff. And so here at New Life Church, we provide a couple ways to give. And on the screen, you can see you can mail your giving, you can text, you can give online, or if you brought it today, you can put it out in the atrium in the box where you put your Connect card. I wanted to say a big thank you to all the people who showed up yesterday for our grounds cleaning day. This was a time to prepare the church for next Sunday, so make sure if you know who those people are, say thank you, because that is a lot of work. We have a lot of grounds to cover out here to get ready for Easter. When is Easter, Camille?
Next Sunday.
So March 31st is Easter. We'll have our regular service at 10:30. So we encourage you to invite your friends, family, coworkers, neighbors. This is a great time for people to reconnect with the church. And right after service, we'll be having our extravaganza at 11:45. What do we need to have an extravaganza, Camille?
Eggs.
Eggs. Lots and lots of eggs. We are desperately in need of eggs. Plastic-filled eggs, no chocolate, please, because it is hot here and it will melt. By the time the kids get it home, it'll be a sticky mess. So bring those eggs. You can bring them all week long. I'm sure you can connect with Dairy. She will be here. So bring those eggs. We do need lots of them. If you brought them today, you can put them out in the white bucket out there. It's usually not a hunt. It's usually just a pickup, so let's make sure it's a pickup this year, again, and not a hunt. A couple weeks ago, we announced the Apples of Gold Women's Ministry. That is starting on April 4th, so I believe there's still a few more slots you can sign up. So if you have not signed up, if you're a woman in this church, this is going to be a great way for our mature women to connect with our younger women. I make sure I get that right. I might get... hurt if I don't. So whether you're a mature woman or a younger woman, make sure you sign up. Brandy will be out there at that table outside after church if you have any questions. If you have signed up, make sure you complete your registration so that you can get everything ready to go on April 4th. And then also on Tuesday night, we have a prayer group that meets. They have been meeting, I want to say, for a year and a half now, almost 2 years. They started praying for our senior minister, praying for a youth minister, praying for our church. And so they have consistently met on Tuesday nights at 6:30. This is open to everyone. If you've never come before, now's the time to join. This is a great time of fellowship and prayer with the people of our church. So can you tell us what's next? Who's going to come on stage?
The kids.
So come on, kids. Let's come up on stage and sing a song. If everybody will stand with them to sing them out, we'd appreciate that.
We're going to prepare our minds now for the time of communion together. And this is a rare time when I thought ahead of time and prepared something. And rather than relying too much on emotion. And then God threw a curve at me this morning. Very emotional morning for me and for Krista, because we're walking through some really tough stuff with our son, and it's ironic because he's in a really good place, like spiritually, from the standpoint of he's pursuing God. And so, I mean, what more could a parent want but for your kid to pursue God and to want to understand him better? And but what we realize from Scripture is that that's not what the enemy wants. The enemy does not want us pursuing God. He wants us distracted. He wants us deceived. He wants us lied to. And so in the process of pursuing God, my son is also being attacked. And so it's got him really, really at times confused and at times frustrated. And so that's the reality for us this morning. She was texting me right before church started and just telling me about the phone conversation that they're having right now. And so that kind of blew everything out of the water that I had planned. I'm just telling you, it sort of took me off into a different place. And so but what it did remind me about when it comes to communion is, and I know I've mentioned this before, it's obviously a time to remember not just the sacrifice and the suffering and the love that was there that was willing to go through all that for us, but it was victory over the principalities and the spiritual powers that are out there that are coming against us. I mean, and so we cannot leave that out of what we remember during this time. And so as we go into communion, as we share this meal together, we absolutely want to remember what Jesus is willing to do for us, the suffering that he endured for us. But again, we want to remember the victory that we have, that it doesn't really matter what we face in this life. Those that have accepted the gift, those that have accepted what Jesus offered in his sacrifice for us, we're eternally safe, and we can endure those attacks, and we can endure those hardships now. But we have a promised place with God. And so we just want to spend this time now being thankful for what he did for us and for the promises that are part of all of this. If you're new here, we want you to know that this is the time for all believers in Christ to share in this meal together. And so you're definitely welcome to do that with us. You're able to come down this center aisle and be served communion here by Misha and Oksana. Or you can go to the tables at the side of the room and take communion there. So, knowing that this is such a important thing that we're remembering, I just encourage you during these next few minutes to put all of your attention and focus on Jesus. And let's keep this time reverent and respectful of what it is that we're honoring. That's the one thing I ask of us as a body and as a family of Christ, that we just treat this time very, very reverently. Let's pray together, and then we'll share in communion. Father, we thank you so much for the victory that we do have. And it's easy to forget about that. It's easy to get caught up in the struggles of life and in the things that are just so difficult. But the reality is that Jesus went to the cross for us, that he paid the price for us, that his blood now covers those of us who believe and have accepted him as Savior. We know that he rose from the dead, that he is with you now, and we're just so grateful for that truth. Let's pray that in these next few minutes we are giving you the honor and the respect that you deserve for what you've done for us. And we pray this in your son's name. Amen.
Good morning, New Life. I don't know if you've noticed, I don't always, I'm ashamed to say that, I don't always pay attention to the words, the lyrics of the songs that I sing. But today it was an amazing reminder of God's faithfulness through several songs that we sang. And it's a wonderful thing, just following a God, believing in God who is faithful. He's the rock. You can count on his word. It's such a blessing, especially in a world where things are so temporary, so fragile. The first passage we're going to look at today, and you might, we'll get to it a little bit later, but you might want to open it now, is Philippians chapter 2. I also, Lindsay said said this already today, I also wanted to thank everybody who came to work yesterday. I'm really grateful for you for just, I know we're a little more sore than usual. Today, I'll admit, holding the tray for the communion was a little bit more challenging, you know. I could feel those muscles. So I do really appreciate everybody. We need everybody we can have here so that it happens faster, things are done better and easier. So, but to those of you who came and showed up and worked, huge thank you. Next Sunday, also, Lindsay said that, next Sunday we're going to celebrate Easter. Easter is, we're going to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. Jesus has risen. That tomb is going to be empty. The stone is going to be rolled away. If not here, it did. The stone was rolled away. Jesus rose from the dead. He's alive. So I want to encourage you to come, but also come and invite your neighbors, your friends, your colleagues at work. I mean, Easter is one of those days in a year when people are more... there are more chances that they will accept your invitation and will come. And who knows, maybe somebody's life will change for eternity. So, I mean, it's worth it. I know sometimes it's scary, but it's okay. They're not going to do anything to you. All you can do is just invite. Say, hey, you're welcome. We'll be thrilled to have you. So, please invite your friends. And also, Easter eggs. The egg hunt, so we need more. I was told that we do not have what we need, so please bring that if you can during the week, if not, next Sunday, but let's have a lot of fun with that. And I also have a little update on the pool. So we did make an announcement about the pool, Sid and Krista did. So we're going to start the fundraiser for our pool upgrades on April 7th. And more details about that, how, when, how long, how much, will be given to you on that day. So, but for now, we are asking you to start praying, praying about how you can participate in that. Okay? So that's another short little announcement on that. April 7th, pray, get ready. Question to you, do you like music? Who doesn't like music? Okay. I mean, I think we all like music. I mean, we like different kinds of music. Everybody's taste is a little different in that area. Some songs or some music, but we're talking about songs today. Some songs have become classics, pretty much. You know, people have been listening to them for decades. And so, do you remember one of those songs, I think, is a song called My Way by Frank Sinatra? Do you remember that? Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think there are some younger people here. So, I thought that I'll just remind you. We'll play a little part of that song, okay? So... Just to remind, to refresh your memory on the about the song.
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear. I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I traveled each and every highway and more. much more than this. I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this. I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was dark,
I think it'll be a little bit more difficult, just by judging by your response, how much I think you love this song, for me to talk about what I want to talk about today. But I mean, it's a great song. Musically, it's just, you know, just wonderful, very good, you know, wunderbar. bellissimo. So I mean, musically, it's a masterpiece. It's got an interesting, very interesting idea and a very appealing idea, and it just causes emotional response no matter how often you listen to it, to a lot of people. And I know in art, you always have to leave some room for interpretation. I know that. But if this song actually means what I think it means, this approach, this attitude of doing things my way, is not the greatest. It's not the greatest one, okay, at best. And I also, I did a little research. Frank Sinatra didn't really like that song either. Really, he said that it was self-indulgent and self-serving. So why? Why is this attitude, why is this approach not very good? And I'm not trying to hate on that song. I will still like it, I will still listen to it, and I don't mind if you do either. So, okay. But just the approach that this song is talking about, doing things my way, why is it not the best? It may sound great in a song, okay? For a song, it's wonderful, it's appealing, it's special, it's something different, you know, and it's, raises, kind of touches your emotions. But just for a second, try to apply that to things like your marriage. Well, ladies, girls, just imagine, you're dating a guy, okay? And he's talking about his future family. He's talking to you, and he says, well, in my family, things are going to be done my way. Will you marry me? No? This side? It's not very appealing, right? It's not so exciting anymore as the song. The song was better, more emotional, sweeter. But you're talking, the guy is proposing and he's saying in his family things are going to be done his way. All of a sudden you're not that thrilled about this idea and approach. Try to apply that to a friendship. Your friend says, we're best friends, and therefore things are always going to be done my way because we're friends, you know? Doesn't work that way in friendship, does it? Friendship is not about that. It's not about having things done the way of one person. Try to apply that to work. You're in a place where your ideas are never welcomed. Your input is not welcome. Or, you know, one of your employees is lazy or disengaged completely. He's not hardworking. He's not, you know, doing his part. And you're saying, why are you doing that way? Where's the source of this attitude? And he goes, it's just my way. This is my way of doing this work. I don't think it's going to fly very well with you if you're a supervisor. Even if you're not a supervisor, working alongside somebody else with an attitude like that, they always do things their way. They want it done their way. It's not working very well. It doesn't work in sports either. I mean, the boys and I, we went last week, we went to Oklahoma City to watch our first ever basketball game, NBA game, okay? That was a lot of fun. But it was fun to watch because the teams, they had their own strategy. They had to support and submit and to play with the same, with one idea. Can you imagine a team where everybody's doing things their way? You came to watch a game and it's a mess. Everybody's doing things their way. The defenders want to score. The people who are supposed to be on the offense, they don't care. They want to be popular. They want people in the stands to clap for them. Whatever. So it doesn't work in sports. It doesn't work in the church either. Everybody is trying to have things done their way, my way. So this my way approach doesn't work, but we carry it into a lot of areas in our life anyway. That's what we do. We get into this area, we get to work, we get to marriage, we get to friendship, and we still sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes we just get caught up in doing things my way. It's got to be my way. So this my way, or the highway 80 approach, I want to say that this is one of the reasons. I mean, it's not the reason, but it's definitely one of the reasons for that there's so many problems in our lives and in our relationships. This approach is actually one of the biggest reasons and the causes of all the conflicts and tensions and the problems and misunderstandings and anger and hurt and pain in our relationships. So what's the solution? What's the solution for that? Well, actually, the Bible has a pretty good one. The Bible that some people say it's an old-fashioned, irrelevant book. Yeah, that old-fashioned, irrelevant book has a lot of good ideas. It's awesome. We need to read it. And it's quite practical. When we try to read it, when we start applying it, we find out that it's quite practical. It's very relevant, even to this day. Even though it was completed, you know, in, what, over 2,000 years ago. Well, not exactly, but about 2,000 years ago. Not about that. We're not talking about that. So it is very practical. It's very relevant to the challenges of our time, to the problems that we deal with today. And so read your Bible. It's awesome. But getting back to the passage that I mentioned in the very beginning, Philippians 2, we're going to read verses from 1 to 8. Okay? We're going to read from the New Living Translation. And Paul is talking to the Christians in the church in Philippi. And this is what he is saying to them. Is there any encouragement from belonging to Christ? Any comfort from his love? Any fellowship together in the Spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate? Then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other, loving one another, and working together with one mind and purpose. So Paul addressing, he's talking to the Christians in this church, and he's saying, bring me some joy by agreeing wholeheartedly with one another, loving one another, and working together with one mind and purpose. I mean, sounds awesome. Sounds like something that we all want. This is something that we all want in our lives, in our marriages, in our parent-child relationships, in our work, in our church, anywhere. This is awesome. How do you get there? Sounds great. Everybody wants it. But how do you get that? And Paul is saying, verse 3, don't be selfish. Don't be selfish. No room for that. I want things my way. No room for that. He's saying, do not be selfish. My way is exactly about being selfish. Selfish is exactly about being my way. Okay? He's saying, do not be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Don't try to impress others. Don't make it about me, 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 me. People liking me, me, talking about me. Having everything, you know, having good reputation, having people think well about me. He's saying, do not be selfish. Do not try to impress. So there's very little, there's really no room to put my way in there in what Paul is saying here. And he continues, he says, be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Do not look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others as well. We're kind of quiet here. You're thinking, I came to be built up and encouraged, not feeling very good now, but I hope we will. So Paul continues, he says, you, two Christians in Philippi, he says, you must have the same attitude that Jesus Christ had. You must have the same attitude as Christ Jesus had. So what is it? What is that attitude that he is talking about? And this is the attitude. Though he was God that came down and took a human body, though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. Not only that, when he appeared in a human form, he humbled himself. He humbled himself coming down, becoming a human. Paul says, that's not where his humbling himself was stopped. He humbled himself even more. When he appeared in a human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. So what's this attitude of Jesus Christ that Paul is talking about and encouraging the Christians in Philippi to have? He's saying that Jesus, he gave up his divine privileges. I don't know what it must have felt for an almighty, omnipresent, all-powerful, all-knowing God to come down and become one of us. That's a big deal. That's a big step. He humbled himself, as Paul says, took a position of a slave. He became human. He's talking about his obedience to God the Father. And he died a criminal's death on a cross. Unfair accusations, unfair sentence, unfair treatment. And so answering our question about the solution to our problems and struggles in our lives and relationships, Paul is saying, it's not about getting my way. It's about getting God's way. Paul is saying, if you want to know where the solution is to all the problems and conflicts and tension It's not about getting my way. It's about God's way. In other words, your song at the end of your life should be, I did it God's way, not I did it my way. The solution to life's problems is doing things God's way, not doing them my way. But it's so hard. I almost hear us say and think, it's so very hard. So hard to make these choices. So hard to make these decisions. When I'm in the middle of a conflict and an argument and I'm mistreated, it's so hard to make the decision to do things God's way and not to do it my way. Well, it cannot be any harder than it was for Jesus to make his decision, to make his choice. Knowing what is ahead of him, Jesus goes to pray right before he gets arrested. This is one of the most intense moments in his life on this earth. So he goes into the garden, he takes his disciples to, and he asks them, pray with me. And then he goes away a little bit, and he starts praying. And we'll read a couple of verses from Mark chapter 14, verses 35 and 36. He went a little farther and fell to the ground. I mean, I don't know how you pray, but I don't think I ever fall to the ground. That should tell us something about what he's going through. He fell to the ground. It was very, extremely emotional prayer. He prayed that if it were possible, the awful hour awaiting him might pass him by. Abba, Father, he cried out. Everything is possible for you. Please take this cup of suffering away from me. And I know I cannot put enough emotion into those words. This was with a lot more heart, a lot more pain, a lot more anguish. This is the cry of his heart. This is why he came. This is what he came to do. And yet, at this very moment, he's terrified at what is ahead of him. And he's praying, sincerely praying, if there's any way possible to avoid that, please let's do this, Father. And then he says the most difficult words to say in the history of the world. And then he says, yet I want your will to be done, not mine. If there's any way possible, let's make it happen. I don't want to suffer. I don't want to be crucified. I don't want to be tortured. If there's any way to avoid that, let's make this happen. But I want your will to be done and not mine. You know, by saying those words, Jesus signed his death sentence. He gave the license to people to mock him, to torture him, to spit on him, to laugh, to call him names, to say all kinds of things, to say that he was helpless, to change anything. He was going, and he made that choice while he was in agony and enormous stress. The Bible says that the drops of sweat, they were the like blood, and that indicates incredible, tremendous stress that he was going to. And he was making that decision, mind you, for those who were several feet away that couldn't even stay up, stay awake and pray for him. He goes back a couple times and they're still asleep. He goes, guys, I need you right now. I need you to pray with me. I need you to pray for me. It's a very difficult moment. And they're like, okay. And he comes back and they go. He makes the choice. He makes that decision. He says those words for those people too. He makes that choice for the people who will later kill him and torture him. He was dying for those people as well. Next Sunday, like I said, we're going to celebrate Easter. We're going to celebrate his resurrection. But there cannot be a resurrection without a death. Jesus had to die first. Jesus had to go through that first. So Paul says, it's not about getting my way, but God's way, including Jesus, even for Jesus. Even Jesus had to make that choice. It's not about going my way, but about God's way. One of the most challenging things in life for us is submission. We don't like doing it. We don't like talking about this. We don't like teaching about this. We don't like learning about this. One of the most difficult and challenging things in this life for us is submission. Submission for spouses, submitting to each other, submitting to authorities. That's a whole nother thing, still a huge question for me. How do you submit to the authorities that are throwing people in prisons and doing ungodly things, and they're just, I'm not talking about that today. Submission to God's will, and this is exactly where some of us are. Or maybe many of us are. This is exactly where we are right now. We're in a situation there where I know what God wants me to do, but I also know what I want to do. And it's so hard to say no to myself and do what God wants me to do. And so the hard question to ask myself is, in this situation, what I want is this right now, wherever, whatever your situation, wherever your dilemma, whatever your choice, the temptation, the trial is, the toughest question is it, honestly answer the question, is it about my way or is it about God's way? And then if the answer is my way, then the question, next question that follows is, what do I need to do to change and do it God's way? What steps, what decisions, what do I need to do to change it and to change it from my way into and do it God's way? What would doing things God's way look like in my marriage? What would it look like? Well, for some, it would be humbling yourself, humility, acting out of humility. For somebody, it's being selfless, not being selfish. For somebody, it would be prayer. Prayer for a spouse, prayer for your children, prayer for yourself included. Maybe for somebody, it could be encouraging your spouse, building them up. Maybe it's just as simple as an apology. But it's going to be God's way, not my way. What would God's way look like in school or at work? It would probably be something like integrity, being the person of integrity, being honest, being an example of a godly person to others, not conforming to ungodly things and ways and principles. What would doing things God's way look like in dating or being single? We talked about marriage, right? But not everybody's married. Somebody is dating. Somebody is single. What would it look like to do things God's way in that stage of life? Well, it's definitely going to be about purity, sexual purity. Honoring God with your relationships, honoring God with your thoughts, honoring God by what I look at, what I watch, what I think, what I wish for. Seeking a godly person, not just some cute or handsome or beautiful hottie. Seeking a godly person, that would be God's way of dating. Seeking somebody who loves God first above everything else. What would doing things God's way look like in my business? Well, it would include things like treating people in a godly manner, in a worthy manner. Keeping priorities, not get so tangled up in your business, not get so tangled up in the money, but remembering that God is number one every day, any time of the day. What would doing things God's way look like in my response to God's invitation to follow Him? I know some of you are still on the fence. You know God is inviting you to follow you, but you've been kind of staying at a distance. What would it look like? Maybe quit running away from Him. Quit running away from someone who loves you, has your best interest in mind, and wishes to share eternity with you, and make a decision to start following God. To sum it up, there are two ways, if that was not clear yet. Two ways of doing things my way and doing things God's way. The songs will tell you that there's going to be no regrets. I don't know if you heard that part. There were no regrets of doing things my way. I'm not hating on the song. I'm going to continue listening to it. Just don't take it as something that you want to follow in your own life, okay? The songs will tell you that there are no regrets after doing things God's way. But if you and I, if we lived long enough, we know that all that hurt, all that pain, all those regrets, all that tension, all that fights, all those conflicts, abuse, and violence are there because of people doing things my way, their way, instead of God's way. We know that. So, my question to you is this: what is your song going to say at the end? When the final curtain, the end is near, what is your song going to say? I did it my way, or I did it God's way. And you know, we finish our worship services every time we say, let's go and make Jesus famous. Well, let me tell you a secret. We cannot make Jesus famous by doing things our way. We can only make Jesus famous by doing things God's way. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so very much for your word and for Jesus, who at the very difficult and the most excruciating and emotional time of his life, he still made a choice and made a decision to have your way. Father, I pray that you give us enough faith, that you give us enough boldness and determination to live this life and do things your way. And I know it's so tempting, and we fall short so many times, but this is why we thank you for your grace, that we can get up and continue following your way. God bless us, please. I want to ask for your blessings for every person that we're going to talk to this week and invite. I pray that for every heart that is right now, that is torn between going and living this life their own way or making a decision to live a life God's way, I pray that you would bless each and every heart, each and every person. And I pray that we would be a church that is so focused on God's way. And I pray all those things in Jesus' name.